I know that things can't stay the same, that change is the whole of the law, that not just the human world, but the earth and the weather and life itself could be different at the end of a single lifetime from how it was at the beginning. You feel that the world, the earth, can die along with you. And I have to ask you, can it?
And now, a moment from the OCCULTURE archive. Episode 16, Brian Abbott, in High Poets Society.
In the publishing world, poetry is such a small, minute, I think, kind of even looked past art. I mean, you go into any bookstore, you find the poetry section, see how big it is. It's one bookshelf, maybe, where a history of cookbooks will be three aisles. So poetry is definitely, like I think you said at the beginning, a dying or a lost art, which social media is kind of, I think, rejuvenating it.
Hey, yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where our primal scream reverberates inside Plato's cave at a frequency of 528 hertz. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for hanging. We've got an interesting show for you here today, a different sort of show, but one that, if you've been listening for a while, should come as no surprise. We're chatting with Gilbert Bates, author of a book I stumbled across earlier this year called Love and the Three Levels of Consciousness. Gil has authored a couple other books on similar themes, but this is the one that we focus on for the purpose of this conversation. The book is about the three levels of the brain, the brainstem, the limbic system, and the prefrontal cortex, and how early emotional trauma is registered as a painful sensation in the lower brain, that brainstem, and the need to repress this pain from conscious awareness leads to a disconnection between the cognitive brain and the social and emotional brain. Gil posits that the disconnection between these three distinct levels, as well as the lack of essential input from the deeper sensing and feeling brain areas, are the root cause of nearly all mental illness and the reason why humans have so much trouble relating to each other in loving ways. We also talk a bit about how to heal ourselves with primal therapy, which is a therapeutic theory and process invented by Dr. Arthur Yanov that's designed to take a subject deep into their social and emotional brain and clear out the traumas that affect us all in some form or another. This book gave me some feels that I hadn't felt before, and you'll find out why during the course of our chat here. So let's cast this pod off into the depths of our primal feel spot, where behind all those painful skeletons lies the uncoiled serpent they've been desperately trying to keep you away from. Enjoy. Gil Bates, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me here today.
It's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Oh no, the pleasure is all mine, believe me. I've been looking forward to this chat for months now. We first connected back in the summertime, and I kept having to push this back, so I'm glad that we finally got here to this point. Before we get into your work, though, please do tell the audience a little bit about yourself. You know, who you are, where you came from, what brought you to this point where you're writing about love and consciousness and these sorts of subjects.
I guess I'm just an ordinary country boy. In relevance to what we're talking about tonight, I was in a 30-year marriage that I was never happy with. There was something, you know, we didn't bond and I wasn't happy. So, and I always wondered what love was. So when I left the relationship, it was to find out what love was. But at the meantime, I had a mental breakdown and suffered suicidal depression. So my interest in life at the age of 45 or 50 that thereabouts became to work out what my brain was doing with sort of suicidal depression and to find out what love was. I went to the medical side of things, saw a doctor and spent some time in hospital and then spent some time with a psychiatrist. So I understand what drugs do to the body, SSRIs, and how that affected me. It dumbed me down. And then I also went to what you might call the alternative or the spiritual side, where I went to shaman type people that to try and find out what was going on. So I believe that I bring that balance to my books, where I've explored both areas of what was going wrong with my mind.
Right. So when I talk to people for the show, you know, most of the guests have either an academic or a professional background in the material that they write about. Do you have a background professionally or academically in things like neuroscience or medicine or similar fields?
No, I don't come from that background. But what I do, my strength is in feeling, in that I write about the three levels of consciousness, which consists of your academic or your intelligence at the cortical level, and then in the system is your feeling, and down below is the sensation. So,
sorry to cut in here, but Gil cut out at that point as he was explaining the three levels of the brain. I mentioned this a couple minutes ago in the intro, but let me recap real quick. Intellect and cognitive function at the prefrontal cortex, then the limbic system where feeling resides, and then the brainstem where sensation is king. Let's get back to it.
My strength is that when I went to America to do primal therapy, which I'll probably talk about because that's integral to my books, is that I went down to feeling and then to sensation, and that's a different thing to what academic or intellect is. It's just the three parts of the brain. So although I don't have an academic background, I did try and study psychology once, but I couldn't do that because it was after going to primal therapy, psychology's a bit dry. So my strength is that I've explored my feelings and my sensations in the lower levels of my brain, and that's where my strength comes from. But, of course, you can't go to a university anywhere in the world to do that. The universities are all academic. They aren't based on feeling or sensation, which is what we need to love each other in this world, to communicate with each other. We communicate at those levels, not at the intellectual level.
I have to agree with you, man. That's just from my own experience. I'm much younger than you, but in my short amount of time here, I think I've realized the same thing. Love doesn't make cognitive sense sometimes. It does not make intellectual sense. You know, like when you try to think about it from that cortex level, right? Is that what we're talking about?
I was going to say specifically the prefrontal cortex, I think they're doing research on. That's our intellectual part.
Yeah.
Okay? Yeah.
So let me back up just for a moment, because I think we should probably define what we're talking about in terms of love. And I pulled out a quote from your book that I want to read. You wrote that love in our culture is still a very subjective experience. And I have to agree with that too. So
yes, yes.
What we're saying there is your idea of love is different than mine. And my idea of love is different than the guy or the gal listening to this right now. But is there an objective definition or experience of love? Is it an emotion? Is it a feeling? Is it a state of mind? Is it all of the above? What, from your perspective, is love?
Well, basically, love is a sensation. I just want to start with using the three-story house that I use in the book, where the top of the house is the penthouse. That's our prefrontal cortex. The limbic system contains our feeling rooms, and the brainstem is our basement. Now, when I did this therapy, I went from you start in the penthouse in your thinking brain, you go and explore your feeling rooms, and then when you explore your feeling rooms, you automatically slide into your sensations. Now, I found that love was an experience in the basement of my mind, and it's an experience. It's not it's different to an intellectual knowing. Love itself, I believe that I got to the stage where oxytocin actually flowed through my body, and that made me feel in love with, I don't know, the universe, I guess. So love is an experience. It's a feeling experience and not an intellectual idea.
Okay. And you mentioned oxytocin. That obviously is what's known as the love chemical, right?
Yes, yes.
Could you tell us a little bit about how the body produces that, or maybe when?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. The body produces it when we get into a loving situation. The first time I experienced it was when I got close to a female about my age. We'd known each other for a while, and then we had a hug, and I felt this warm, loving feeling pervade my whole body, and I was 62 years old, and I'd never, ever experienced anything like that before. And I thought, wow, this must be oxytocin releasing in my mind, and it's putting all this wonderful energy through my body. And it was just an amazing thing to happen at 62 years of age. I finally got to feel what love was. I'd never had that experience before, so I guess that because I was so repressed, that my body would have been full of stress drugs. So when I got to feel, actually get rid of my primal pain in the basement of my mind, which we'll probably talk about later, the primal pain in the basement of the mind, when I got that out, it lifted the repression, and then I was able to feel love, an amazing experience.
Could you compare the feeling of what you felt, what you just described to us, could you compare that to anything that the average person who's listening to this might be able to identify in their own lives as a similar experience?
The thing that comes to my mind is sunsets. Like people say, when you clean out your a bit of stuff, the sunsets look brighter, but it's like I could actually almost feel the sunsets, you know? And I guess the short answer to that is no, you can't really do it because it's an experience, and there's nothing that I can say that can give a person that experience. You have to go down into the basement of your own mind to experience it. But I guess there are things that happen, mostly in the spiritual sense, where people describe things that happen and say it's spiritual, and they might say, I don't know, belief in God or whatever else. But it's actually the basement of your mind that you're experiencing. And I write about that in the book as well, that our spiritual experiences are just experiences of love, and we don't understand what's going on.
How often do you think people feel love but reject it or close themselves off to it because it doesn't align with their belief of what love is or feels like?
The main problem is that we carry primal pain, and the moment that we confront a loving situation in our lives, we can't feel that because we're going to open up to the primal pain that's in our basement of our mind as well. And from my primal pain came from parents that didn't love me. My mum had too many children and she couldn't love me. My father was a violent alcoholic. So my ability to feel love was shut away from the same system in my brain that shuts down the primal pain so that I can't feel that. So a shut down the pain shuts down the love as well. Now when I'm confronted with love in my life, and as many people are, you can't open up to that love because it's going to open you up to your primal pain as well, and that's very painful. And the therapy that I do actually opens you up to primal pain, gets rid of the primal pain, and then you can start to feel love. So the answer to that is most people can't feel love because we all carry a lot of primal pain, and that blocks our access to love.
Yeah, we can talk more about this later, but I've been there, done that, and it's not pleasant. I don't want to get into that right now, but I know exactly what you're talking about. So back to the book, though. You actually start this book with one of the simplest yet, I think, most profound observations on the state of humanity today. You wrote that, quote, "Perhaps the biggest problem and the one that underlies most of humanity's ills is our inability to relate to each other in a positive way." I could not agree with that more. Our society seems to be fueled by this like sickening 24/7 infotainment cycle, which itself is fueled on like the most negative and depressing bullshit that we can find. And it's no wonder that, you know, like, for example, when I look at social media, that I see just a plethora of regular people who do nothing but complain about what's wrong in their lives. And, you know, this is inherently negative behavior, and it's reinforced by the fact that, you know, say, a Facebook post from someone calling Donald Trump an asshole gets hundreds of likes, while another post from someone about how important it is to love yourself barely gets any likes at all. So I'm just curious, you know, going back to your quote then, why do we have such a problem relating to each other in a positive way?
Well, mainly it's our defense system. If we're critical of other people, it becomes part of our defense system to keep us away from our primal pain. I get all this stuff about Donald Trump too, and although I don't agree with some of the things, it's like he's still a person. And when I've opened up to love, I respect all other humans, regardless of race, creed, whatever, you know. But so I'll come back to the energy of love itself. The energy of love gives us respect for other people. It provides for our ethics and our morals. And we're basically all the same at that level. In the basement of our minds, we're all the same, and love makes us that way. And we need that loving energy to be able to respect other people. There's very little respect shown on Facebook. It's just awful what people do to each other, both left wing and right wing, you know. Love would bring everybody into the center in a loving community, and that's what we need.
Yeah, and you also said in your book, blocking this energy or repressing this energy is causing the actual brain to malfunction, and that if we can... Well, why do you say that? How does the brain malfunction by blocking this sort of energy out?
It malfunctions in a lot of ways. One of them is to create delusions. I don't think people understand this, but it's like, I don't really want to bag religion, but religion is a bit of a delusion. Primal pain is the thing that we carry, and people don't realize it. And the medical profession, like the neuroscientists and the psychologists, don't understand, because they're taught in an intellectual way. They never have to go down into the basement of their minds to find out what's down there. And that's not, knowledge isn't intellectual, it's an experience. You have to experience that. And so we have to defend against primal pain. We defend against it. And so our mind goes, rather than look inward, we look outward and we bag other people. You know, we don't let other people in. We would like to, but we can't let them in, because it's going to open us up to our primal pain. So the understanding of love is one thing, but you also need to understand the forces that primal pain have in the brain as well.
Yeah, you wrote that the pathways in the brain that are used to repress this emotional or this primal pain also block our access to feelings of love. Now,
exactly.
Obviously, primal pain goes back to childhood for the average person, you know, and you mentioned this earlier. You had parents that didn't love you, and that's what you posit in the book, is that, you know, parents who don't show us enough love in a proper way, or who don't teach us how to love, or maybe the love was forced out of us in some way, maybe through societal conditioning, where it seems that, you know, fear is preached more than love. But these are the things that block us from accessing that later in life. So,
yes.
And again, these are inherently negative behaviors, especially when you go to the societal part of it, fear-inducing behaviors. So I'm curious, if there is anything practical we can do to open up these pathways in our brain again, like psychedelics are beneficial in that regard, but that might not be practical for a lot of people. So what sort of advice can you give us on how to unblock our feelings of love and get rid of this primal pain?
Just on psychedelics, in some ways, psychedelics open us up. They seem to get underneath the defense system, and they open us up to the feelings of love. If I read what psychedelics experience when they're having a trip, that's basically what I found when I enter the basement of my mind, and I'm not on drugs. I'm just down there to clean out the primal pain. So you asked me, how do you clean out primal pain? Well, that's where primal therapy comes in. Primal therapy understands the brain as three levels of consciousness, and to start with the intellectual part, thinking about your life, what's going on, you can't get on with your partner. Well, how does that affect you? How do you feel about that? Now, we get confused with emotion and feeling. A lot of people show emotion, but it's not feeling. You've got to get to the underlying feeling of what's going on. So, and people spend all their lives tending to project outwardly onto others, Well, during the process of primal therapy, you've got to go inward to see how you feel about things. And that's a journey in itself. And then you eventually go down into sensations, into the basement of the mind. And that's how I did it. And there are a lot of therapies out there that try and do that. But it's like, well, we have primal pain and we need to get rid of that. So whatever therapy you do, you need to get primal pain out of your system, which a lot of therapies say they do, but they don't. And science, we need science to come on side to prove this, but science can't prove it because they're still in the penthouse of their mind. They're still at the intellectual level. They need to somehow prove that we have sensations, powerful sensations at the level of the brainstem. In actual fact, the brainstem is the most powerful part of our brain. It's the part, it's the engine room. It's the part that drives us. We're not driven by our intellect. We have intellect's a wonderful thing. But to be a fully functioning human, we need the three levels to be communicating with each other, the intellect, the feelings, and the sensations, especially the sensation of love that drives everything or should drive everything. But instead, most of us have primal pain that's driving everything, and that's where we're falling apart as a species.
Tell us a little bit more about primal therapy. You are a primal therapist, but tell us how you discovered it.
I actually went to a tantra thing here in Melbourne, Australia, where they dabbled in feelings, but they provoked feelings. It's kind of like primal therapy in the early days around 1970s. They don't do that anymore. So I actually had some primal feelings where I lost control of myself, like very deep emotional stuff. And then when I came out of it, I had feeling came into my body. Like after that, I found this primal therapy and one of his first clients said when he came out of a feeling, he can feel the carpet. And my experience is very much the same. I feel things in a lot more sensitive way now. So it's like feelings come back into my body.
Tell us a little bit about where primal therapy originated, how you came to connect with it here in the States.
I had several experiences like that here in Melbourne, but the people couldn't tell me what was going on. But the big thing that happened to me was my sex life got better for about a week or so. You know, it's like there was this opening and into a better feeling life, and that also applied to my sex life. So I had that opening for about a week, and then of course, with the natural going back to work and getting back into the society, that door in feeling closed again, but it would always remain in my mind. Now, when I read the book Primal Scream by Arthur Yanoff, he explained what actually happens, that you open the door into feelings, and there's a way that you can go in and keep that door open. Just keep exploring the feelings, get the primal pain, and now my feeling door is open all the time. I'm connected on all three levels. So when I read Arthur Yanoff's book, The Primal Scream, which he developed this theory in the late 60s, early 70s, but it was fairly crude and fairly rough then. But it's a lot better therapy now than it was then. But anyway, I went to America to have this therapy. I thought, that's for me. So it got rid of my suicidal depression because I went down and cleaned out my primal pain, and then my brain had nothing more to suppress, so my depression lifted. And my suicidal thoughts were incorrect imprinting at the level of the brainstem sensations. And then much to my surprise, it also opened me up to feelings of love, and that's really was a magnificent happening with the therapy. I didn't think that would be part of the therapy, but it did. It opened me up to feelings of love, which is just fantastic, fantastic way to live your life.
Do you mind if I ask, what was causing your depression? Was it your marriage or was it something else?
The marriage was a result of my primal pain, that my mother didn't love me or couldn't love me, so I was always going to choose a woman that couldn't love me as well, like as marriage. So it's like it just follows on. And then you get traumatized as a child, you carry primal pain, and then you live your life out of that primal pain. And it's like most people, you just live a life of what the hell's going on, you know. And I've suffered suicidal depression, wanted to hang myself when I was about 28 at some stage, you know, and sort of got out of that and then got suicidal again when I was 46. So the primal pain gets imprinted in my body. For myself, I think that the imprinting started when I was actually in the womb, because my father was violent and he would bash my mother around. And if I'm in the womb, I pick up the energy. If my mum dies, then I'm going to die soon. So I also had a lot of fear in my life. So it's imprinted in the brain there and then. And then my marriage was just a result of my primal pain. I was never going to marry anybody that could love me because that's what my mother was. And I couldn't let love in either. I found that I couldn't let love in even when I was presented with it because it was opened up to my primal pain. And I would run from any woman that was showed any signs of loving me, which is same silly.
Well, no, I think it's pretty common, actually. It sounds silly when you talk about it like this, but I think when you actually observe people, most people I've met in my life, the people that they're romantically involved with is a direct result of what we're talking about, is they seem to shut themselves off to real experiences, real love, and they sort of settle for something lesser because they don't know any better. But to that point, but to that point, Gil, I've also met some people that are happy. That are happy in their relationships, regardless of whether or not what they have is true love, they do seem happy and content. Why would that be?
Basically, they don't know any better. In my book, I write about a Gale score where I give people a score of 1 to 100, where 50 is your very neurotic, your borderline psychosis, and 80 is where I put where my oxytocin started to flow. So people say, like I was 50. I was very neurotic, borderline psychotic, and now I've raised my GAL score up to 85, where my oxytocin flows. But the difference in my life between 50, a score of 50, and a score of 85 is just mind blowing. It's just mind blowing. When I had a score of 50, I didn't know that it was how good it was possible to feel with a score of 85. And so that's where people are. They have a good life. They have a reasonable situation. They might have a Gale score of 70, say. And so they say life is fine. But they don't realise how good it would be with a score of 80 or a score of 90. And that's where we are. And this is partly due to the defence system that doesn't let us know how much primal pain we're carrying.
I do want to explain this Gale score more. This is the Global Area of Love score, GAL score. You created that scoring system in your first book, Love, Sex, and Mental Health,
yes.
And then you talk about it more in Love and the Three Levels of Consciousness, too. What is that score exactly? How do you determine it? What's the formula for it?
It's kind of a formula out of my own head, but it needs to be – a lot of the science these days is on people's perceptions of whether they're better or not. So that's you're asking a person about what's going on in their intellectual mind. Whereas actual fact, you've got to go down into the basement of the mind and read that part of the brain because that doesn't tell lies, and that will give you things like the blood pressure and stress hormones and that sort of thing. That'll drive that. So that can be a level of it. If people smoke, they're going to have a low Gale score because that's a smoke, and drinking alcohol, that means that you're trying to kill your pain. People who take heroin are obviously going to have a low Gale score because their amount of primal pain, they need heroin. With my amount of primal pain, alcohol seemed to do the trick. So for me, so all those things come into it to develop a Gale score. The interesting part is now, though, that science is proving, I don't know whether people have heard that the adverse childhood experiences, the ACE thing, is becoming big now. And that's a similar thing whereby if you've had 10 or more traumatic things and happen in your life, they did the research on 10 or more things. Now, I happen to have six of those things, like my father was violent and divorced and that sort of stuff. But if people suffer four of those, they're more likely to suffer cancer and those sorts of things, and more likely to suffer from a disease. So science is starting to develop their own Gale score, in a sense, that if you have one bad childhood experience, you're not going to be so bad off. But if you've suffered four, you're going to be really bad. If you suffered six, you're going to end up in a mental institution. So the science is sort of backing that in a way, but they'll need to do a lot more work on it, when they understand the power of the brainstem sensations and understand the severe amount of primal pain that we all carry.
Well, I'm still curious, though. How do you determine a Gale score by number? Like, what's that process like? How do you know that you're an 85, or how do you know that you're a 60?
So I'm going to read a Gale score between 90 and 100. Supreme functioning, life dominated by feelings of love, monogamous, heterosexual, had loving parents, only eats healthy food and drinks, has many good friends and strong relationships. How many people can say that? that they have good friends and strong relationships. Many people are lonely and suffering because they've got more pain and they can't relate to other people. So people like that, I'd give a high GAL score to. Truthful and trustful. How many people are truthful and trustful in their life? Our politicians certainly aren't. Our politicians all have low GAL scores because they tell lies and they do whatever else. And they're power hungry. When we don't have love, love is a very powerful force in my body. And when people don't have love in their body, they replace it by the power of control of other people. That's one of the big things that we do. And that's what politicians are good at, mostly. And good neuronal activity, heart rhythm, sleep patterns, brain activity. Now, I'm going to go to where I was between 50 and 60. No long-lasting relationships, divorce very likely, major social problems. So if you're having all those things in your life, you're going to have a low GAL score. And it tells me that you've got a lot of primal pain when those things are happening in your life. Substance abuse, heavy smoker, physical sickness. Cares less about personal appearance or becomes obsessive compulsive. All those mental disorders, which is the thing we haven't discussed, mental disorders are just basically reactions to primal pain. So the more severe mental disorder you have, it tells me the more primal pain. So that means the lower the GAL score you're going to have.
Yeah, you actually explained in the book how depression and anxiety form in the brain and why. Could you take us through that?
Yes, I can. And we need to understand, depression is a good one, and we need to understand the three levels of how the three levels of consciousness work, in that when we're babies, we only have the sensation level. Our brainstem is almost fully functioning, but we don't have a developed limbic system and definitely not a prefrontal cortex. They develop later. So when my father was violent and angry towards me and I suffered fear and my mother didn't love me, it's like I experienced the pain of not being loved is too much for a child to feel, so it gets repressed away. And that's basically depression. Now, when I'm older, I suffer depression, but nobody told me that it was primal pain. My system, my top level of my brain, the prefrontal cortex, is keeping the primal pain repressed, and that's just depression. Now, when I did primal therapy, I went down and dealt with the primal pain. When the primal pain goes, there's nothing more to repress. So the depression lifted. I don't suffer depression anymore. Because I think that's very important in understanding depression. And the medical profession don't understand that at this stage. Because they don't understand the three levels, because they don't understand the three levels of the brain functioning.
So they're focusing on the prefrontal cortex. Obviously, that's the first level of consciousness. And you just said that they're not digging deep enough. So when they focus on treating it, then they're really only treating symptoms instead of treating the cause. How do we change that, though? Like, and not even in science, just in our own lives. Like, how can we treat our own depression or anxiety at that base level instead of just the symptoms of them?
I don't think there's any way you can do it yourself, because once you go down lower into your feelings, you lose where you are, and then you can't take yourself where you need to go. People can have feelings. There are a lot of therapists around that can get people in the feelings, and they get relief, and then they think that they're getting better. But you've got to continue that journey. It's like the house and it's got a stairway. You've got to continue down that stairway, and that's what primal therapy does. Understanding primal therapy is part of the process. People really can't do much by themselves, which is unfortunate. You can either live with it, and you can take yourself, you can get relief by understanding that depression is just repressed feelings. You're holding feelings down, but you really do need a trained therapist to do that.
So something like meditation or mindfulness practices, these are not what we're talking about. This is not very effective at those base levels, right?
No, because they're intellectual things that are treating the symptom. Cognitive behavior type therapies are, that's what they are, cognitive behavior. They're trying to change a behavior in the upper echelons, whereas the behavior is actually driven by the need to repress primal pain at the level of the basement, level of the brainstem. And you've got to go down there to treat the cause. And when you treat the cause, everything else above that stabilizes, comes back to normal. You'll have oxytocin flow, you won't have depression or you won't have anxiety because you've dealt with it at that lower level.
Yeah, you actually wrote too that the three levels of consciousness all have different ways of experiencing and perceiving the world. What's the difference in perception and experience at the first, second, and third levels? How can we identify if we're experiencing and perceiving at these different levels?
It's difficult to describe that because I can only communicate that at the level of voice and intellect. But I'll try and give some examples. When you're crying or you're feeling emotional pain and you say, the pain was that much, I can't describe it. I can't tell you what it's like. Well, that's the feeling experience. That's what it's like. You have to experience that. So that's they're describing what a feeling is like. I can't tell you how painful that was. But the feeling can tell you how painful it is. It can tell me how painful it is for me, but it can't tell you how painful it is. And sensations is a little bit harder, but it's like when people, what comes to mind is when people have near-death experiences, what they're doing is shutting off their, like they go into a comatose state, they're shutting off their intellectual mind and they're getting access to the basement of their mind. They're getting, like people describe near-death experiences as white lights and it's pure love. And what you're doing then is experiencing the power of love in the basement of your mind. You're not going off into heaven or wherever else you may think you're going. It's just you're opening up into the basement of your mind.
It's probably because your prefrontal cortex is shutting down. I guess you would look at it like levels losing power. Like the first level, lights go out. And then the second level, lights go out there. And then that third level still on. That's where you're experiencing this near-death state. And the whole white light, the whole flooding of I guess DMT maybe is what we're talking about too, right? Like just being able to experience that pure nature of love.
Yes, couldn't have said it better myself.
So you also wrote that the major aspect of this defense system is that it does operate at a subconscious level.
And yes.
So we're not aware that our thoughts and behaviors are governed by this need to really express that pain. And I mean, we don't realize that these behaviors are stemming from this basement, and that's a kind of a pun, I guess, now. They stem from the brainstem, right? So we don't realize that our behaviors stem from this basement that's just full of, like, think about somebody who hoards things, you know? They have rooms and rooms just full of shit that they don't need, and that's sort of how we're describing the brainstem here, is that it's just full of all these boxes and things that you just don't need. You just want to get rid of it so you can clear that primal pain or that energy out of it. So I think that's what we're talking about here.
And sure. I see those things on TV too, where these people have houses full of rubbish and they're trying to get the rubbish out of the house so that they can make the brain work better, but they're going about it the wrong way. They've got to go down into the basement of the person and clean out the person's basement, and then the rubbish will just fall away. It's like my anxiety and my depression just fell away once I dealt with a primal pain in the basement of my mind.
There's another good example that you shared in the book that I really enjoyed. It's sort of an extreme example, but you wrote that an example of this primal pain is the paranoid person who sits in a closet with a tinfoil hat. You know, this is the quintessential description of a conspiracy theorist. You know, somebody who sits in his closet with a tinfoil hat on his head so that the government can't beam his mind with mind control. But underneath, though, all these crazy ideas is the pain of an unloved childhood, which probably contains aspects of not being able to communicate with your parents. So
yes,
I will tell you that this passage, Gil, struck me pretty deep. It really activated a feel spot. I went through a phase where I was very paranoid, so I get the analogy, but I still am a sucker for a good conspiracy theory. But like I said, they do make me very paranoid. So I actually went through a particularly traumatic period in my life in early 2015 where I was extremely paranoid, deathly afraid of something. I couldn't sleep, and for the most part, I've worked my way through that. But the paranoia still does creep in from time to time, although the effect it has on me is not as debilitating, perhaps. And
yes.
As I've done some self-reflection over the last couple years, as I've really taken the time and effort to get to know myself, I've come to the conclusion that people close to me, my parents included, do not really know how to communicate with me, and I don't really know how to communicate with them, which I think is extremely frustrating and sad and disappointing, and maybe even a bit ironic, because here I am hosting a podcast and having a conversation like this with you, which is very raw and very honest, and obviously I can communicate well enough on some level to be able to do this. I'm not sure I even have a question here, but if you have any thoughts on what I just said, I'd love to hear what you think. Why can I not communicate well with the people I really need to and should be able to? Whereas, you know, here are you and I, it's the first time we've ever chatted, and we're having this deep emotional conversation. Why do I have a problem, or why do the people around me have a problem communicating so much?
The first thing I thought of with that start of that conversation was, and you mentioned that guy with the tinfoil hat in the cupboard. Well, and when we're talking about the GAL score, Global Area of Love, he's so far delusional that I probably would give him a GAL score of 40 just on that one symptom, that he's in the cupboard with a tinfoil hat. You've got to be really paranoid. You know, you've got to carry a lot of primal pain to get to that stage. Look, when people understand primal pain, there are signs all around. There are signs all around that we do have this primal pain in the basement of our minds. It's just that we don't recognize them. And depression is probably the most glaring state. The people at Harvard will tell you that they don't understand what depression is and they don't know how to cure it. And I just say, well, I'm not a Harvard person. I'm a country boy. And I'll tell you that depression is just the system repressing primal pain. And the way to cure it is get rid of the primal pain. Now, that's pretty simple. I think that's pretty simple, but it's not out there. You know, the knowledge isn't out there.
Yeah. So, and I think to that same point, you mentioned too that the fear of making mistakes is one of the most common causes of this primal pain. And it comes from childhood, you know, where you may have had parents who are too strict, don't give you enough freedom to explore, punish you when you make mistakes. But then there's a flip side to that where you see parents that push their children to do well in school, but we don't realize that that's actually putting a lot of pressure on them. That could possibly lead to a state of anxiety. And it seems that our culture does place a lot more emphasis on a high IQ and how well you perform academically, which, as we've outlined here, I think on some level, that those are prefrontal cortex activities that come from the intellect.
Yes.
And we don't really focus on the social functioning, the social aspect, which starts in our brainstem and goes up to the second level in the limbic system.
Yes.
There. I guess this is probably a question for parents then. What can parents do better to shift their focus back to those bottom two levels that we really need to focus on?
First of all, it has to become part of the human species narrative, and it's not at the moment. I think it's getting there. Parents are starting to realize that through the adverse childhood experience, there are a lot of people understanding that it's the trauma early in life that's the problem with mental disorders later on. But they talk about trauma, and I in my third book, I talk about, it's not specifically trauma, it's lack of love between humans. And if a parent's been traumatized themselves and they've got a low GAL score, they can't communicate with their child in a way that's going to bring that child up in a loving feeling way, if you understand what I mean. Like I had a GAL score of 50 and I was damaged, but I was aware that my parents had damaged me, so I tried to be the best parent I could, but I was too cynical and I couldn't show love. I didn't have a good relationship with my wife, and so my children struggle, but I did the best I could. But we've got to become aware of it. This is what I hope comes out of this podcast or whatever, or And for the rest of my life, I'm going to try and promote this idea, or it's more than an idea, it's an actual fact for me, that we have three levels of consciousness, and they're all different ways of being in this world, and we need to understand that. And I agree with you that universities can give you a bachelor or degree or whatever else. That tells you how intelligent you are, but it doesn't provide you for life. For a feeling life, for a loving life, that life. And I would like to think in a society in 50 or 100 years' time that people will also be given a GAL score and saying, well, you know, you need to do something about this as well. This is, the GAL score is going to be a whole lot more important in a person's life than what an IQ is, because a Gale score will measure the lower brain's activity, and that's where we're failing as humans. That's why we're having depression and anxiety epidemics and all that sort of stuff. We're treating each other badly because we're shut off from that loving energy that lies in our lower brain.
Yeah, that reminded me of a quote in a book or a movie that I heard one time. Someone said that dumb people fall in love. And I think that's what we're talking about, is that maybe dumb people intellectually, but we're saying that, you know, that doesn't matter anyways. So love has nothing to do with how smart you are. It's like we said, it's a feeling. So even if you have a low IQ, you could still feel that. That still makes life worthwhile.
Yes, exactly. And there are a lot of people that people in our community that really do have a low IQ, but they seem to be happy all the time. And I think that's why they're not getting all tangled up with their high IQ. They're just living life how it should be lived, for just feeling.
They're not thinking so damn much about every little thing, you know. That's what happens. Yeah. See, that's my struggle. I'm not saying that I'm smart or intelligent. I'm just saying that I think a lot about things. I have had a long history of overanalyzing and overthinking things in my life, and it has led me nowhere good. It's always been destructive. It's a self-destructive, I think, tendency to overthink and overanalyze. And, you know, back to my mention of mindfulness, I've come to learn that mindfulness is not, I don't want my mind full. I actually want it cleared. So I think the way that we think about and talk about these things, you know, I know meditation and mindfulness practices are on the rise. They're very popular now, but I don't think that they have the same effect on it as something like primal therapy can have.
Mindfulness can help some people to control their thoughts, but we've got to, and maybe that will still go into the future with primal therapy. If people don't want to do primal therapy, not everybody can do it. Well, you can do mindfulness, which slows your mind down, but you have to understand that it's only you're only treating the symptoms, and you're going to have to do it basically forever, forever and a day, because as soon as you stop meditating, the push of the primal pain from the brainstem takes over again. And that's one of the things I love about doing this therapy is I practiced meditation and mindfulness with an Indian guru for about 12 months until I got thrown out. And I was trying to reach a mind state that, you know, that they say you can, that's possible. But I found that I've reached that mind state through primal therapy. I can go and sit under a tree now and I don't have the thoughts. And if I find myself thinking, I think, no, it's being. We're human beings, not human doings or human thinking. And I sit out underneath the tree and it's just great to be just all that. I don't have that mind chatter now, but the best state of mind is just when I'm in feeling, and I know whether I'm in an intellectual state of mind, a feeling state of mind, and the deeper states are the sensation. I understand where I am, and that's what I didn't understand when I had that suicidal depression. I couldn't understand what my brain was doing, but I understand where I am now. Those three separate states are important. If anything comes out of it, I'd like people to understand that you've got three separate states, and they are separate states, and you need to have them communicating with each other in the way that they communicate. And then that's how life, that's the joy of life, when you can have your minds, and especially when you can connect to your feelings of love that arise from sensations in your brainstem. It's wonderful.
Are the three levels of consciousness the same concept as the triune brain theory, or are these two different ideas?
It's very similar. I would say that primal therapy takes it a bit further, but it's the same idea. It's the triune brain theory, just enlarged a bit, you know, understand at a deeper level. Because we evolved, the triune brain theory says we evolved our brain stems first. So in some, like 300 million years ago when we were, We survived quite well just with sensing our lives. And then we got to the feeling part of our brain evolved later. This is what we're told. So then we survived quite well and evolved quite well just by being sensing feeling people. But now that we've developed the thinking brain and we're treating each other badly, we've got to keep our senses and our feelings suppressed away because it causes pain when we treat each other badly.
Can you tell us a little bit about the physical pathways of love in the brain? Are there physical pathways for love to flow in the brain?
See, I wrote about this in the first book. There's a pathway that goes from the top of the brainstem. So it's a well-known pathway because dopamine is fueled by dopamine. And a lot of addiction studies are focused on this pathway and the dopamine pathway. But when you look at it, love is a type of addiction too. If you the more you get, the more you want, and you want your fix every day. You know, like it's a kind of an addiction, but it's a really nice addiction. So, and that's the same pathway. I'm kind of aware of that, but I think it's something that science needs to prove. But the pathways are there from the top of your brainstem through your limbic system and then up into your prefrontal cortex, and that's the connecting pathway. But you'd have to talk to a neuroscientist. But they don't see it from that way. Neuroscientists will become more informed when they go down into the basement of their mind and experience what it's like to be down there. Then they'll come back out of that and say, well, no, we need to rethink what we're doing.
That's pretty fair. I would think a neuroscientist would have been schooled in the way that where they're only focusing on that first level. So that makes complete sense. What are the three pillars of a healthy life?
Well, one of them is love. You need love, okay? That's the main thing that we don't have. And then we need good food. And that's what we're not doing. We're not eating good food. We're eating all this trash and processed stuff. And we can do that because we don't have feeling. What primal therapy's done for me is that it's opened my body up to sensations, and my body senses whether a food's good for me or not. If I go down to the takeaway, local takeaway, and have a feed of whatever fast food there's there, I don't want to mention names, but my body says that I go sluggish and that food's not good for me. If I eat a salad of grated carrot and cucumber and some herbs in it, my body says, wow, that's live, that's energy. And in actual fact, there's a branch of psychology or psychiatry that's trying to promote food as being part of treating mental health. But what happens is if you eat bad food, of course your body's going to be sluggish. And when you eat good food, you're going to feel better. That's just natural. And the other thing that we need is exercise. When we evolved and we had to go out into the environment every day of our lives to collect and gather. And so exercise became an integral part of how the cells work and how our body works. We need it to pump lymph around our system and that sort of stuff. And it's science is showing that our cells work better if we exercise every day. And we've become a society that just doesn't get enough exercise. So they're the three pillars of life. I basically put that in the book as a type of filler. but it's relevant to the fact that if we understand the three levels of consciousness and every level's in contact with each other, we're going to do more exercise and we're going to naturally eat better.
Yeah, I read a book a couple years ago called The Mind-Gut Connection, which really changed the way that I live my life. And that book posits that your gut biome, your gut bacteria are directly linked to, you know, brain performance. If you're eating a bunch of fast food from the takeaway, you know, that is going to mentally affect you. So I'm curious, though, when it comes to love, though, does the gut bacteria, that biome, is that affecting our ability to love as well?
It's a good question. When we love ourselves, we're not going to put rubbish into our system. And when we start eating good food, the gut biome behaves properly. We get all the enzymes and that we need from good fresh food. And if you love life and love your body and you have feelings of love, you're not going to eat so much rubbish. And the energy of love makes you real. Like a primal person becomes real in the sense that we don't have belief. We don't believe in anything much. We don't have false beliefs or delusions. We just, well, this is how life is. And that's a great way to be. It's not as if we walk around like zombies. It's quite an exciting way to be. Don't worry about all these belief systems. Like, I don't want to be a left swinging voter or a right swinging voter. That's all just rubbish. Just be a human being and just enjoy this journey through life. And that's what primal therapy's done for me, and that loving feeling. It's more than love. It's a way of being in this world. It's a complete way of being in this world.
What role does social isolation play in someone's life?
We're not meant to be socially isolated. We can do it for a certain amount of time, and that's fine. But I think when we go home, we need to socialize with people. We need to eat with people. I have a need. I live by myself, and I have a need at the end of most of my days to talk to people about what's happened to me. It might be 10 or 15 minutes. I really miss it, and I don't have that. I can live my life by myself and while I'm busy doing other things, but as soon as I think about my life in a social context, I get lonely. And a lot of people keep themselves busy all the time so that they don't think about their loneliness.
I was just curious because, you know, I also live by myself and I do keep myself quite busy. But then I realized too, like, well, shit, like maybe having all this busyness about my life is really holding me back in some way. So yeah, I was just curious because you mentioned social isolation in your book. And, you know, obviously that spoke to me personally because I do live by myself, like I said. But I've also found solitude to be pretty powerful on some level too, which I think you did touch on that. You know, it can be good for a while. I understand we probably don't want to get stuck by ourselves, but. You know, I was wondering, have you heard that quote from Carl Jung about coming to consciousness?
No, I've heard some quotes from him, but I'm not sure of the one.
He's got a very famous quote. There is no coming to consciousness without pain.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes, I do.
The rest of that quote is, people will do anything, no matter how absurd, in order to avoid facing their own soul. One does not become enlightened by imagining figures of light, but by making the darkness conscious. And I think that's what we're talking about. Going into that basement, very dark, and digging through all those boxes of that primal pain, getting rid of them so that you can, you know, shine some light down through there, right?
Yeah, actually, I think I've got that quote in my book. If I haven't, I was going to because it's right. And you sent me something, an introduction to one of your podcasts that you did earlier in the year. You talked about that dark room, and I thought, my goodness, he's describing primal therapy here. That's where you need to go. You need to go to that dark room inside you. The thing about Jung's statement is there's no consciousness without going through the pain. I would say let's not put the pain there in the first place. Like, we all carry primal pain, but we shouldn't. I'd like to see a society where we just don't damage our children. When we love our children, we love each other, and we don't put the pain there, because once it's there, it diverts our humanity in quite horrific ways, and it's a damned hard, long, expensive journey to get it out as well. So it's like I say, well, let's not put it there. Let's not put it there in the first place.
So one of the problems that you describe in your book is that the brainstem and its sensing apparatus, that they do hang on to old truths as if they're still real.
Yes.
And that's, I think, what we're talking about when we talk about this pain is imprinted on your brainstem.
Yes.
So how does pain get imprinted? Is it like an energetic imprint, or is it a physical imprint? Is it like, if you see a brainstem that has this pain, does it look more stressed? Does it look more worn out?
What they're doing with the research is methylation. They're finding that people who have mental illness, or children who have a lot of childhood trauma, have a lot more methylation. And the methylation changes the way the DNA, you know, what it does. Instead of going left, it goes right, or something like that. And it gave me depression instead of giving me the feeling of love. I would like to think that I had a lot of methylation of my DNA before primal therapy, and now I would hardly have any. But I think that's what science has got to prove. Science it's not going down that track because they don't understand the three levels. When they talk about methylation, they talk about producing a drug to change the methylation. Well, that's that you're introducing something physical into the body when it's not something physical that caused the problem in the first place. It's an energetic sensation between two people, between parents and their child. It's energetic. This child senses that it's not love. It doesn't work it out in an intellectual. It senses, and so the cure isn't some drug that you're going to put in the body. The cure is to go back and relive that sensation, relive the trauma and get that trauma in crying and grief and whatever else. And then that rights the system. It righted my system. And I'm thinking, I believe that science will be able to prove that one day, that the system, like, get somebody before they start primal therapy, do all the tests and methylation, and then couple of years later, and that'll come about when science understands the three levels.
Yeah, but science is still very materialistic. I'm wondering too, from just an individual perspective, does this material society that we live in, that drives this consumer behavior, you know, like wanting to have things around us all the time. Is that materialism derived from a collective primal pain?
Yes, it does. It's like the house we were talking about earlier, where people would accumulate things, then can't get rid of them. Well, that's not good. And it's like how much is enough? $5 billion enough? No, when you get that, you want $10 million. And you're trying to fill a black hole that's inside of you, and you can't do it with things in the present. It's like, and that's the same with relationships. We go into relationships trying to get love from our partner, but the partner's trying to fill a black hole inside of us, and they're never going to do it. And so we complain like buggery, you're not doing this, you're not doing that. But you gotta go inside yourself and feel the pain that's caused that big black hole. And then like with yourself, with your parents, if your parents dealt with their black hole and then you dealt with your black hole of your primal pain, then you communicate a lot better. I communicate a lot better with my children now, and the really good thing is I can communicate openly with my grandchildren, in a sense that I couldn't communicate with my children because I was damaged. Now I'm not so damaged. And my grandchildren respond to that, not in an intellectual sense, but they respond to my just being in their presence in a loving state of mind. And they'll just come up and give me a cuddle or sit on my knee or do whatever else they feel like doing. And I remain open to that, and they respond to it. I'm not sure how I got there, but that's where I went.
I'm glad you went there, because that gave me a nice little warm, fuzzy feeling as you were talking through there. I guess I got a couple more things here, Gil. So Earlier you mentioned false belief systems. We mentioned religion and politics in there. Those are the two best examples of false belief systems, and also probably two of the most promoted and marketed. So, you know, there's probably some bullshit there. But there is something within religion specifically, you know, this idea of God. How do you see God? Is it love, maybe?
Yes, it's love. I consider love. I don't particularly want to bring, like I talk about God in my book. People say God is love, but God has given us religion, and it's got 300 or 400 different religions or whatever else, and then we fight amongst each other. Well, that's not love. You know, that's definitely not love. So I just talk about love, and I think we need to look at that. We need to look at love from a scientific perspective, not whereas religion's just a belief system. And if you have love flowing through your body, your belief systems drop away. Your political left and right stuff will drop away too. The thing about love is that it contains our ethics and our morals. So it's like religious people say, well, you need the Bible to give you our ethics and morals. Well, my argument to that is that love contains those things, and they're much more real and much more functional than what a belief in God is. So I think that's why, you know, the three levels of consciousness and love especially is such an important concept, that we don't need a big brother to look after us, because if we have that loving energy and we have our own moral and ethic base, we're not going to go off and do bad things, because we're naturally going to be good to our fellow human beings through the feeling of love. And that's what we don't understand. We don't need all these bloody rules and regulations that we have. We only need them because people are delusional and have these strange beliefs, so we've got to keep them in line. But a person in love with life and has that loving feeling will naturally be good human beings.
Man, I could not agree with you more on that. Before we wrap this up here, Gil, I want to say something to you that I would probably normally reserve for my post-conversation summary. I am going to ramble on here for a moment, so I apologize in advance, but I just have to say this. When I read Love and the Three Levels of Consciousness, that book made me cry. Not out of sadness or frustration, but out of joy. Your passion and your compassion really comes through in this book, and I felt that love that you have inside of you for your fellow man, and I could not have been happier myself as I was reading through this. I read parts of this at home, at work, in coffee shops, and no matter where I was, I could not help but just be overcome by my own emotion. I actually remember specifically sitting in a Starbucks one night and having to go to the bathroom because my eyes got watery, and I had just let all that emotion out. So yes, I cried in a Starbucks bathroom like a 14-year-old girl. But still, this book summarizes everything that I've come to learn over the past 2 to 3 years of my life, but it also elaborates on those lessons in ways that I never could. You have the data here, you have your own personal experience, and you have a way of explaining these concepts and ideas in, you know, a simple matter-of-fact tone. And I'm so glad to have stumbled upon your work and your story, and I could not be more excited to share it with the audience here. And this podcast is called OCCULTURE, and we talk a lot about a lot of hidden and esoteric aspects of society. You know, various belief systems and philosophies and stories. But to me, the most occulted and esoteric system and philosophy and story is the one of love. And it sort of pains me to see people sleepwalk through life without knowing what true love is or what it feels like, without truly experiencing how powerful it is, how transformative it is, and how healing it is. And I will say, you know, going back to part of our conversation about social isolation, I found myself in solitude, you know, socially isolated after a relationship that I was in for nearly 6 years after that just ended. Now, you know, 6 years is how long we were physically together. But I realized in my solitude that our relationship, our love, if it was even that to begin with, that it had ended long before we physically parted ways. You know, we just sort of, I think, clung to it out of habit and out of fear. But once I got into that solitude, Gil, I experienced love for the very first time. I found it within myself. I changed my lifestyle completely. Proper nutrition, more exercise, you know, and those are, to me, signs of treating yourself with love. And I started doing that, and I realized I'd never done that before. I'd never experienced love before. Now, I'm not completely healed. I could definitely use a few rounds of primal therapy, but your book and this conversation and this experience has validated the choices that I've made in my life. And not that I need any sort of validation, but to know that I found the strength and the courage within me to put myself on the right path for the first time in my life, I can't thank you enough for giving me that validation through your work. And I know you don't need any sort of validation, but I do hope that the time that we've spent here has at least let you know that you and your work are important and impactful and appreciated and very much necessary. And if only one person hears this conversation, we will have both done a wonderful and tremendous service, because these sorts of conversations do not happen in living rooms or on front porches. They don't happen in coffee shops or at the office. But I hope that we've at least given our listeners the strength and the courage to have this conversation with themselves. And I could talk for another 10 minutes, but nothing I would say would come close to expressing how much gratitude and appreciation and love that I'm feeling right now. And while I don't have the words, I did do something. Right before we got on the call here, I ordered 10 copies of your book, Love and the Three Levels of Consciousness, and I plan on gifting them to various people in my life and also giving away a couple to some of our audience members here. So it's the least I can do for you. It's the least I can do for people that I love and care about, and for the listeners of this show, who I appreciate every single one of them. And one last thing, and then I'll shut up. At the beginning of 2017, I posted a podcast episode. You mentioned it previously. It was episode number 11, where I read a poem at the beginning by an 18th century Chinese painter named Huang Shen. And it was just a 5-line poem, and this is what it said. I want this year to be my renaissance, a rebirthing of my dreams. Like painting poetry, I want to feel again. And I made that my daily resolution to open my heart up for really the first time in my life and to feel everything, to feel joy and happiness and satisfaction, but also to feel pain and sadness and be conscious of it so I can harness it and transmute that darkness into light or that suffering into love. And I've worked hard to do that this year, and it has not been easy, but it has been so damn satisfying. And it's fitting for me to end this year with this conversation, because it shows me how far I've come to be able to have a conversation like this openly and frankly, and share it with not only each other, but to share it with anyone who wants to hear it. And I could not be prouder of myself, Gil, for the progress that I've made this year, for allowing myself to see my own value and my own worth, and for allowing myself to feel again. And your book was part of this journey for me. I read it twice, you know, once back in the summer and then once in the week leading up to this conversation here. And I cannot thank you enough for not only being here and for your time, but for putting a cherry on top of my self-love Sunday this year. So thank you so much.
Okay, can I say something to you now?
Absolutely.
I, I'm feeling warm and fuzzy too, I suppose. I cannot describe how I feel. I'm just feeling very, very kind words. The thing is, I want to say is that sometimes I feel alone in this because I can't talk at this level with other people, and I want to change the world. You know, I've changed myself. I guess I want to change the world, and I'm not going to be able to do it by myself. So I'm excited that you've come on and you've accepted this, and I can't do it alone. So when I get people like you to come on board, that's great. I hope that by the time I die, there is other people that can carry this forward, you know, and people like yourself and anybody else. I hope it brings understanding with some people. I think that's what the three levels of consciousness can do. Bring understanding as to why we are like we are. But like I say, I can't do it by myself, and I really appreciate your efforts, and I hope that we reach more than one person at least, you know. So thanks, Ron.
Well, hey, yeah, you don't have to thank me. The pleasure is all mine, and the gratitude is all mine. And I can tell you for a fact, I know many listeners that I've talked to privately that will be happy to see this podcast episode pop up, because they are very much into love. They realize that it's present all the time. You just have to do a little digging to get to it. So we'll have more than one listener, believe me, and we'll have more than one that identifies with the theme of this conversation, with the message that we're trying to put out there. So please do tell our audience where they can find you on the internet and where they can get your books if they're interested.
Just Google Gilbert Bates or Gil Bates. And if you go to Amazon, I've got three books on ebooks. So if you just Google my name, I don't know what else you can do. When I Google my name, there's all that stuff comes up.
Well, we should also mention you do have your own primal therapy website, gilbatesprimaltherapy.com.
Yes, I do.
Yeah, so if people are in Australia, and we do have some listeners down under, if they were perhaps interested in working with you to get some primal therapy, they could go to your website and they could book a consultation,
yes.
Right?
Yes, they could. I've also got a blog called The Three Levels of Mind, which discusses the three levels of mind and primal therapy too, because that's an integral part. So yeah, I've got the books out and a website.
Absolutely. Well, I will link all of those in our show notes, so if people are interested, they can just click on through. Gil Bates, I know I just rambled on for like 15 minutes, but I really cannot thank you enough for your time and your work and the message that you're sharing with everybody here. I don't have any words left for that, but just again, thank you so much for being here.
The feeling's coming through.
Absolutely, yeah. And I do hope we activate some of those feel spots here for sure. All right, Gil. Well, thanks so much again. Take care of yourself.
Okay, same here. Bye.
Hoo-wee, what a beautiful chat that was, IMO. My thanks again to Gil Bates for not only being here, but for turning me on to something that was lying dormant in my basement for 33 years. I know some of you may not make heads or tails of this chat, and that's fine, but I do hope that it resonated with some of you as well. I haven't undergone primal therapy, but I've done what I can on my own, and I have to say that self-examination is not an easy process to undertake, because you have to remove yourself from yourself, if that makes any sense, and sort of look at you as you would look at another person. Study and observe your actions and behaviors and thoughts and feelings, and really dig through to the core of it all, to the core of you, and ask yourself, is this person really living their life with love? Or are they choosing this path because these traumas are unhealed, because this basement is full, because your energetic style is cramped? Like I said, not easy. But if you can at least begin to clear that space, I guarantee you, you're going to look at you and your life very differently. You're going to see things you've never seen before, you're going to hear things you've never heard before, taste and touch new things, and most importantly, you're going to feel things inside you that you've never felt before. And all of that is going to scare you. It's terrifying because you've never experienced anything like it. And you may want to pull back from it because it's so unfamiliar, but you won't be able to help yourself. You'll feel drawn to it magnetically, electromagnetically, and you won't be able to turn back as much as you may want to. But once you give yourself to that force, you'll finally know what it's like to be free, to not be at war with yourself, but to finally be at peace.
No more chains or shackles. No more black iron prisons. Just you, finally existing in a state of your own truth. Just you and a clean and clear Godhead. Hey, let's do some house cleaning of our own here. I owe a copy of Tracy Twyman's novel Genuflect to Ed Wolf. Ed was the first to leave a 5-star review on iTunes after our last episode with Tracy. I'd like to read that review to you now. Ed's headline, Awesome Insights and Honesty. And he writes this, Ryan does a really great job relating and explaining his topics so that newbies like me who have just been delving into the rabbit hole of these subjects can understand them. He asks the questions that I would ask and his topics are always compelling. The latest podcast, parenthesis, I've been listening for almost a year now, was one of his best with Tracy Twyman and was truly enlightening and has inspired me to do much more research on these topics for myself. Thanks for the continued good work, and I really appreciate your efforts. Keep it up. Hey, Ed, thank you so much for the 5-star review and the kind words yourself. If you shoot me an email at occulture@protonmail.com, I'll be sure to get that book to you as soon as possible, occulture@protonmail.com. And I'm glad that Ed mentioned the whole newbie aspect, because that is the role that I'm trying to fill here. The niche that I'm trying to fill is sort of that entry level into these topics, because that's still where I'm at. That's really how I've structured the show, because I can't talk to some of these topics at a certain level, but I will be able to in the future. You're learning and growing with me here. And like I said, really cool that Ed picked up on that. And speaking of book giveaways, I've got 2 copies of Gil's book, Love and the 3 Levels of Consciousness, to give away. One of them is for the next person to leave a 5-star review of the show on iTunes. We're up to 26 now. Let's get that to 27 so I can get this book in the mail to you. But you have to write something. Otherwise, I don't know who you are. You can just click 5 stars and not leave a note, but it doesn't show me who you are if you do just that. The only way for me to see that is to do what Ed did and write a few words, a sentence or two about the show. Be the next person to do that, and you'll get a free copy of Gil's book. The other copy is going to anyone who's already left a written review of the show. If you're still listening, that is, and want a free copy of Gil's book, use that same email address that I just mentioned, occulture@protonmail.com. Be the first one to email me with interest in the book and proof that you left your review, and I'll get it in the mail to you as soon as possible. A big thanks goes out to David Baker over in the UK for being the latest recurring monthly supporter of the show here. David is helping transmute this podcast by donating at the Alchemist level of $7.77 a month. Thank you for your support, David. You are helping this show go from black and white to red and yellow. Also, our Patreon campaign going live in the next couple days. I'll have more on that in our first episode of 2018. I also just submitted the show to Spotify. I don't know how long it takes for it to show up in their directory, but it should be there soon. So if Spotify is easier for some of you, please do follow the show there or tell your friends who use Spotify that this podcast is there now. Turn them on to something new in the new year. And to all of you who've been following the show this year for however long, thank you for making this worth it for me. The support and the love has not gone unnoticed. And even though I don't personally recognize January as the beginning of the year, here's to the next year in the Gregorian calendar being full of even more love for yourself, even more thinking for yourself, and a whole hell of a lot more questioning authority. I'm not going to be able to do that.
Please rewind this cassette.